Between 1841 and 1901, the population of Dundee tripled from 45,000 to 161,000. In 1883, over 1 million bales of raw jute were unloaded in Dundee. By the turn of the century, the industry employed more than 50,000 people in over 100 mills. The city was truly the jute capital of the world.
The manager's house up there.
All right.
Yes. Now, this is one of the oldest industrial areas in Scotland.
Is it? Yes.
In the 18th century, most of the trade was with Europe.
All right. So when was this built, roughly? Any idea?
1833 for this one, but there was lots of mills in around here. And this is called Verdant Works. It comes from Italian for green.
Oh, I see. Oh, yes.
But our next door neighbour is Meadow Mill. This was built on the outskirts of the city. Now, the gatekeeper, one of the things that he would do, you see the steam whistle up there?
Oh, yes.
He would sound that whistle, called a bummer. So people had to be at work before the bummer stopped.
All right.
Otherwise, the gates would be locked and they'd
that's
be
steam
losing
driven,
key.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm. The sewer and burn runs through this mill.
Yeah. Lovely. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Okay. You never know in Dundee there might be a drought. And
So that was here.
That's here, yes.
The circle. Cool.
Okay.
Lovely. Thank you so much.
I'll leave you in peace just now and I'll see you when you
get
the
mission. Thank you for your help.
Natural domestic life is how he described it. Biling the kettle became a way of life for thousands of men unable to find work in engineering, shipbuilding or the newspaper industry. To add to their misery, most of them worked in the mills as boys, but were paid off before they could command a man's wage.
Are you sitting nice and comfy? Right, I'll tell you a fairy story. Once upon a time, in a big city, there lived a young lad called Robbie, who went to work in a large jute mill. Time rolled on, and Robbie became a strong young man of 18. He never got the sack. He never depended on charity handouts for his sisters, his mammy, his granny, and eventually his wife. He never became a kettle boiler. God. Fairy stories are depressing in Dundee, son. Let's change the subject. Now, what was that song we learned at the Berries? So be easy and free when you're drinking with me. I'm a man you'll know meet every day. Well, maybe you'll be a man like that day, son. Easy and free. I'm not so sure about your daddy. Christ, I'm getting about as greedy as a bairn. It's just my father and my grandfather worked in the shipyards, built Discovery. And here I am sewing sacks for halfpennies and changing nappies for love. For love of you and your mother, son. Bonnie and brother be to you.
The rye on my mind, pair of them. Heela made his broth. Best plate of soup on the hat, he says. Half he proud of it. I wish he had a butty mare to be proud of for his sake. When I give him money for the pub now, I never ken if he'll come back sentimental or just plain mental. He's ferocious when you're drinking him. No, he's sell. My daddy was the same. His escape was going to be the army. Even my ma said that he had to get away to get back his self-respect. When the recruiting officer told him he was physically unsuitable, he gave his pride such a dun. He couldn't have thought it on him here. Drink was the only way out. Robbie's stronger, though. He's got to be. Sometimes I wish he was hairless like some of the ones I ken. We never hear a finger to wet when we gave him ear them in here.
Dundee was known as She-Town due to the dominance of its women in the labour market. Suffragette meetings were always popular. One in Gilfillan Hall was attended by 1,700 people and hundreds more had to be turned away. As the Dundee Advertiser commented, meetings have been attended by crowds of people whose demeanour has proved that sympathy with their cause is both widespread and warm. Thousands of children were employed in Dundee's textile mills. Out of 30,000 child workers in 1883, more than one-third were under 18 and about one-fifth were under 15 years of age. Dundee's expanding textile industry, the Carmichaels looked to new technology to increase production and soon became famed as makers of steam-driven textile machinery. By the time the high mill of Verdant Works was built in 1833, Britain's industrial revolution was reaching its climax. England's dark satanic mills were in full production. And in Scotland, fortunes were being made and then multiplied a hundredfold. Toward the end of the Victorian era, Scotland was producing a third of Britain's railway engines, a third of its steel, a third of Britain's ships, and half of its engines. It is against this historic backdrop that the incredible story of jute in Dundee was played out. This drill, originally driven by the line shafting, was used to alter and adapt machine parts. The step pulley system to the right would act like gears, allowing the user to control the speed. The majority of the machinery, mill furnishings and tools required by the Dundee jute industry were produced and maintained either by nearby foundries or by in-house engineering departments in the larger mills. During the Industrial Revolution, Scotland became known as a centre of excellence for engineering and invention. The genius and skills of Scottish engineers and entrepreneurs were responsible for many significant developments within transport, communication and industry, causing this small country to have a disproportionate impact on the world. Thomas Telford, one of the greatest civil engineers of the industrial age, designing bridges, roads and canals. Bolton and Watt Engine, Douglasfield Bleach Works, Dundee, 1801 to 1802. This internationally significant object is one of only five Bolton and Watt beam engines remaining in the UK. It is the only surviving Watt engine that worked in Scotland and the only one that remains close to its original place of working. Overhead sack sewing machine, used to sew jute cloth into sacks. Overhead refers to the form of stitch, an adaptation of the old type of hand stitch which could not be unravelled easily. Scotland's first steam-powered mill was in Glasgow in 1793, with Dundee's following in the same year at a mill in Guthrie Street, where an atmospheric engine was installed. Electrical power was introduced in factories to drive machinery. The first mill in Dundee to fully adopt electric drives was Hillbank Linen Works around 1905-7, making among the first to do so anywhere. Line shafts were turned by electric motors on each floor, the electricity being generated by a steam turbine in a turbine house. Dundee and India connected by a single fibre. In 1820, the first 20 bales of jute were unloaded at Dundee Docks. It was to change the city's destiny forever. So how did the fortunes of a Scottish city and the faraway region of the Indian subcontinent become so intertwined? The answer, in part, lies in Dundee's industrial traditions. Weaving, whaling and shipbuilding were the three vital ingredients that made Dundee the jute capital of the then modern world. Weaving was an important occupation in Dundee as far back as the 16th century, so the skills were already in place to adapt to jute processing. The local whaling fleet provided the whale oil needed to soften the jute and make it workable. And Dundee's shipbuilding industry, another offshoot of the whaling heritage, was put to work to construct the big, fast ships that brought the jute from India. On top of which, new worldwide markets were opening up for jute products. A fact the enterprising merchant community was quick to recognise. Thank you. Verdant Works is a Category A listed building of national architectural importance and a rare surviving example of a courtyard-style mill. The High Mill is the oldest and most physically dominant part of Verdant Works, with impressive architectural features. An imposing three-story building, the mill retains many original features, including the decorative series of Gothic cast-iron roof trusses, the ground floor columns bearing brackets for line shafting, power transmission by belts from the engine to the textile machines, and an original lift. Verdant Works is so called for the green fields and extensive nursery grounds that surrounded the site when it was built in 1833. Increased dependence on employment in the mills brought about changes in the health of the people of Dundee. The population had grown rapidly. Between 1841 and 61, it rose by 30,000, with only 568 new houses built to accommodate the increased numbers. Living space was at a premium and sanitation practically non-existent. In 1863, the average lifespan of a man in Glamis was 60 years old. In Dundee, it was 33 years. In 1832 and 1849, there were outbreaks of cholera in the city. Outbreaks of fever were so regular that at Baxter's, a doctor would visit the works every day, and bottles of medicine were kept at the factories to dose the workers should any symptoms appear. Smallpox could be found in Dundee long after it had disappeared from everywhere else. Typhoid lingered in the city as well, reaching epidemic proportions in the 1880s. Diseases thrived in the homes of Dundee mill workers, who lived in cramped dwellings that were almost wholly devoid of sanitation. People worked long, exhausting hours. In 1833, boys might work 18 or 19 hours a day in some mills. Often children fell asleep over their work, which increased the likelihood of industrial accidents. Other work-related health hazards included wet spinning of flax, where children could spend up to 13 hours a day in a drenching hot spray. The very poorest families could only afford meat in the form of suet for a stew. Those with a little more money bought cheaper butcher's cuts, such as rabbit or sheep's heads or scraps and bones, to cook up a broth. White bread, margarine, tea and sugar became the staple diet. Bread was the largest item of expenditure. These new, mainly imported foods were quick to prepare. Very important when the majority of women were working. Eggs, milk, cheese and butter were a part of the diet of Dundonians in the early 19th century. They were made in rural areas around Dundee and could be bought in the city. These foods made up a healthy diet, but took time and trouble to buy and prepare. Later, the increasingly difficult lifestyle of Dundee workers meant that money and time were too short to buy and cook such basic ingredients. Jute is one of the most versatile natural fibres known to man. Raw jute fibre is obtained from two varieties of plant, Corchorus capsularis and Corchorus olitorius, both native to Bengal, modern-day Bangladesh. During the 19th and early 20th centuries, jute was indispensable. Its uses including sacking, ropes, boot liners, aprons, carpets, tents, roof felt, satchels, linoleum backings, tarpaulins, sandbags, meat wrappers, sailcloth, scrims, tapestries, oven cloths, horse covers, cattle bedding, electric cable, even parachutes. Jute's appeal lay in its strength, low cost, durability and versatility. In 1864, the works ran three steam engines driving 70 power looms and 2,800 spindles. 500 people were employed, making Verdant the 16th biggest employer in the Dundee jute industry of the time.
Train apprentices how to repair and how to maintain machinery. So that's the jute when it comes in.
Yes.
Very hard, very dry.
Yes.
Okay. Now, jute doesn't have its own oil. Originally this was a flax mill, opened in 1833 by David Lindsay and Company.
Oh.
Okay. Now flax has its own oil, the linseed oil, but jute has to have an oil put in. It's done at an early stage.
Oh, that's it.
This is a softener behind me. Now this one's been deliberately shortened to get it into this shed. In a factory setting it would run the whole length of this hall. And there'd be more than one of them in a shed.
Have you been in the industry yourself?
No, I wasn't. My dad worked in the jute mills, but by the time
in Dundee?
In Dundee,
oh,
yes.
Did he? Oh, yes. Yeah, so you got a good background of that then.
By the time I was leaving school, a lot of the mills were closing.
Yes.
Jute had run its course in Dundee.
Yes.
Now, there's still a very active industry in India and Bangladesh.
Yeah.
About 250,000 people employed there. Dundee jute barns invested in the factories in India and Bangladesh.
Mm.
And of course that's where jute grows. It grows very quickly. It grows to a height of about 15 feet in 6 months. They'll then harvest it, they'll grow rice in those same fields. So that's the jute after it's been through the softener.
Right.
Now we don't spray it with our oil and water solution at this stage anymore because it's a bit messy.
Yes.
What we do instead is we'll leave it sitting on a barrel here and we'll take a water in. Now in the factories it would have sat on a barrel for a couple of days to let the soap and the oil solution work into
yes.
the fibres. And
soften
then after
it.
A couple of days it'd be gone through a machine like this. This is a breaking carding machine. Now this one has guards on it but the ones in the factories wouldn't have.
No.
Now the only health and safety rule was that if you had long hair you would tie it up. In 1857, there was a girl pulled into a machine by her hair in this factory.
And how old, roughly, would she have been? Would she have been a girl?
She'd have been a teenager.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, inside this machine, there's six drums, and they're fitted with these needles. Oh. They're called hackles.
Excellent.
Now, in Dundee, you'd call them heckles. Yeah. Dundee language is quite rough. Okay? This is where heckling comes from. Yeah. When you're heckling your politicians, that's the source of it.
Oh, that's
when you're giving them a little bit of needle. Dundee was very militant, particularly the women's suffragette movement.
Yes, I noticed that on the museum.
This machine tears at the jute and makes it a little bit more like wool.
Yes, more manageable.
More manageable, yes. Now, it's a machine that needs two people to operate it. One would load at that end, there'd be somebody at the other end catching in these cans. Then it goes on to finishing carving. Now, because jute's a natural product, it comes with all sorts of colours, it comes with all sorts of flaws. By mixing different cans here, you're getting a more consistent quality of product.
Yes.
If you mix four cans here, you have a very light thread. And through that light thread, you might make scrim. Now, plasterers will use scrim.
Oh, yes.
They'll put it into walls, they'll plaster over it.
Yes.
But you'd use that too for carrots, bags, onion bags, cabbages.
So where would that be made then, from the raw material?
They'd make a thin thread, and then they'd weave that on the loom.
In Dundee?
In Dundee, yes. Not any longer, of course, but this is the only place in Britain that processes jute now. But...
Is it?
Yes. Yes.
Right.
So it now goes on to drawing. Now, these are quite small drawing machines. The ones in the factories were much larger. You can see them in the photograph there. And there'd be 50 of these in the shed. They're quite noisy machines. I would go to school on a bus, the bus past the jute mill, and I could hear this noise while I'm sitting on the bus.
It is noisy, isn't it?
It is noisy, and there wouldn't be any ear protection.
And where would these machines be made?
A lot of them are built locally.
Okay.
I think these ones come from Leeds, but the softener's built in Ardroath. The roving machine's quite local. The spool winder's Ardroath. The cock winder's Monifieth. The loom's Dundee.
Yes.
Well, it was part of the industry in this area. You had people making
a lot of good engineers came from Scotland.
Yes.
Didn't
they? Yes.
Yes.
Now, these machines are combing the jute. They're drawing it through a series of needles. So by the time it gets to the other end of this machine, all the fibres are lying in one direction.
Right.
At that stage, it's very delicate. That'll just pull apart.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Our next process is called roving. And all that roving is, giving it a little twist.
Give it strength.
Giving it strength. So this is our roving frame here.
Did workers have ear restraints in those days,
no,
or didn't they bother?
No ear protection at all. Lots of them were quite hard of hearing by the time they retired.
I was thinking of that, yes.
That's the way it would come off roving.
Yes.
Dundee women would knit with roving. They'd knit rovies.
Mm-hmm.
Their kids would be barefoot in those days.
So we're talking about Victorian times, aren't
we? Yes, Victorian times, yes. But probably into the early part of the 20th century as well.
And how long would one of those last, I wonder? Wouldn't last long, would it?
I don't know the answer to that.
No.
But they just knit another pair then. Okay. Now, all of these machines that you've seen so far, they make up the low mill. In Dundee, you had the high mill and you had the low mill.
Yes.
These are big, heavy industrial machines. You wouldn't want to put them upstairs.
Yeah.
In addition to that, the processes up till now have been quite basic. There's no real skill about the processes so far. The bobbins that come from here, though, now go to the high mill. And in the high mill, you have your spinners and you have your weavers. A bit of cloth has two types of thread on it. You have the thread that goes all the way through the bale, and it's called the warp.
Yes.
And you have the thread that goes across the way, it's the weft. Okay. Now, the warp needs to be much stronger than the weft.
Does it?
It gets a bit of punishment at the loom. It's the one that the shuttle passes underneath and over the top of, and forms the weaving process. So the skill of a spinner is making a good, strong warp thread. So you would do that by slowing down the material as it passed here. This would trim, this would stretch it out, and then you get the flyer flying at a faster speed and making a tighter, narrower thread. Now, it wouldn't need to be as thin as this one, but that would be the way it came from spinning.
Yes. So there's quite a few processes, aren't there?
There's quite a few processes.
And they're all on one shop floor?
They wouldn't have to be. This is a Verdant Works, and Works would do the whole process.
The whole process,
but some places were just mills. They wouldn't do the weaving then.
Oh, I see.
And that's... again, really just the thread that's come from spinning, but it's a much thicker thread.
Yes.
It would be sold by weight. So after spinning, it goes into winding, and it'll be wound into one of two shapes. If it's a warp thread, it'll be wound onto a spool. And that's a spool. I'll put this spool winding over here.
So the noise must have been incredible with all this machinery going at the same time.
Well, each of these machines would have its own separate hall. Yeah. And there'd be more than one of them. For instance, the softeners, there'd be two or three softeners. There'd be 50 of the drawing machines.
Yes.
The roving machines would be in a separate bay.
Right.
So they wouldn't all be set out in the way that it is here.
No. Mm-hmm.
Now, the other shape that we want is something that'll fit in the shuttle. And this is called a cop.
Cop.
Now, this is what this machine's making. And it'll fit in there, and it doesn't matter how tightly it fits in there, it'll get pulled out from the centre. And you'll see this shuttle's a different size. So what we could do is we could put a different collar on the cop winder.
What's this made from?
This one's made of plastic.
That's plastic?
Yes. 1960s, everything went plastic.
Oh, I see. Before then it was what, all wood?
Yes, wood.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Very, very interesting. Thank you.
Just about ready to start weaving. We don't need to do anything with the cops other than use them in the shuttle. The spools though need to go onto the back of the loom. Now even a loom this size has something like 220 threads. So we can't have 220 spools sitting behind the loom. What we do instead, we make up this piece of equipment here. It's called a beam. Okay. Now you won't see the beam that's on this machine because of the angle the loom's sitting at. But we have a spare one and it's sitting down here. And you see all the way along it has holes.
Yes.
And a little notch in each of these holes. Each of these holes is going to take a hank. Now this is a beam winder, it's going to help us make that hank. Now this beam would normally sit up there, and this is a motor drive here. So to make the hank, we have a bank over here, and in the bank we have 20 spools. We've gathered the ends of all 20, and we'll wind them round this reel. There's a clock here so we can measure how much material is going onto that reel. Now the only thing that's important is that all the hanks are the same length, otherwise you're going to waste material. In here we'll use 200 yards. It doesn't have to be 200 yards, but as long as all the hanks are the same length. And when we've got our 200 yards, we'll tie a knot in the end of it, and when we've made enough hanks, we'll slip the knot into these holes, and because they've got this little notch, they won't come out. It would then be a tenter that put the beam onto the back of the loom. Now, a weaver had to earn her money. She was on piecework. She got paid for the amount of cloth she produced. She has two looms to look after. There's one in front and there's one behind. You can see in the photograph there. Now, late 1940s, they invented this kind of shuttle. It's different, it doesn't have a cover on it. Instead, the cocks are held in place with these brushes. It works with a device that holds the cocks in a rack called an echo loader. The echo loader automatically loaded cocks when this was empty. The weavers no longer had to do that. Now, the downside for the weavers is that they no longer have two looms to look after, they now have six. Yeah. Now, there's 300 looms in a shed. This is one of the reasons that weavers tended to go deaf. Cox's in law, he had two weaving sheds, and each of them had 500 looms. Could you imagine 500 times this many?
Amazing.
Now, one of the reasons that they converted from flax to jute is that jute is very versatile. Jute goes into something like 600 different products. And this is some of the cloths that they made with jute. Okay. This is called twill. Now, twill goes into settees, it goes into chairs, it goes into beds, and this is what gives strength to the furniture. You won't always see it, it'll be covered over with some nice fabric. And when men wore three-piece suits, this would go into the collars. That's what gave the collars that stiffness. This is sacking. The main purpose of this would have been sandbags. Needed millions of sandbags during the First World War. They would have needed sandbags to help cope with flooding and all sorts of other things. But they'd also put this through a waterproofing process. Then they'd make tents and aprons and tarpaulins. They used it to line boots. They made hose pipes out of this. This is the cloth that went on the wagon trains that opened up America. Potato bags. Rice and flour. They made clothing with jute. They'd make rope with jute. There's a lady imports jute into Dundee. She makes coffins out of it. They're eco-friendly. Now the biggest job for jute was backing for carpets and backing for lino. Now, this is the manager's sample book. He could offer his clients all these different weaves. Now, if it was going to make backing for carpets or lino, it would have to be flat and it'd have to be smooth. So it would go through a machine like this, a calendar. If it wasn't flat and smooth, and the hot linseed fell on it when they're making the lino, very likely this would go on fire.
Yes. Yeah.
Now that's the cloth that the weavers liked to make because they got paid a higher rate for that one. Weavers had to be good at finishing off the cloth. If there's a broken or missing thread, they would have to fix that before we got paid for the cloth. It would have been quite hard to darn this.
Yes.
So they got paid a higher rate. And that one, you see it runs diagonally. On your loom you've got screens. They're called cams. Now this is a small loom and it only has two cams. These here, they carry the water beds. If it had three cams, you'd get your diagonal pattern. And if you had four, you would get herringbone. All goes to add to the quality of the cloth. Now, 52,000 people worked in the mills in Dundee. It's industry that built Dundee. 1840, the population of Dundee was 45,000. By 1900, it had trebled, due substantially to the mills. There was over 100 mills. In addition to the mills, there's people making the machinery, there's people making the hackles, making the shuttles, making the bobbins. So it was a huge industry.
Mm-hmm.
1960s came along, we got new houses, we wanted fitted carpets. And the machines that we had in the mills in Dundee weren't wide enough. Mm. For fitted carpets, you need something that's 3 metres wide, 4 metres wide.
Yeah.
So our machinery went to India and Bangladesh. We got new automated machines. They went on to continental shifts. They'd start at 6 in the morning till 2, then 2 till 10, then 10 till 6. Machines never went off. But they still couldn't compete with the price of cloth from India and Bangladesh.
And that's when things went downhill.
And that's when things went downhill.
Yes. Okay.